So I suppose we can start. And these are the questions that are remaining from yesterday. Now, we're going to look at those first of all, and then we'll move on to the other ones afterwards. Okay, number one. Dear Ajahn, I just wanted to say that Merson, who wrote the question yesterday regarding the husband, Scott wrote us that I hope this retreat gives you that I hope this retreat gives you the space to contemplate your next course of action. It sounds like you've really been suffering, and I hope you get the courage you need to do what you need to do to take care of yourself. With much metta and silent support from a friend. Okay, good.
That was. Okay, thank you.
There we are. So that was just
there we are out again. So that was just a message of support from one of the retreatants to the other ones, which is nice.
Okay. So next one then. Dear Ramani, I am an addict to food. I cannot stop eating until it ends, and then thinking obsessively about eating again. My health is worsening. Is it? Okay. Good then. My health is worsening. Is there any advice you could give me? Thank you very much. Okay, so what do you have to do is obviously you need to somehow, you know, if you are an addict, and if this isn't what is going on here, it's like if you are smoking cigarettes or whatever, if you're going to have any chance of giving up your cigarettes, you have to make it difficult to get hold of cigarettes, yeah? If you have cigarettes lying around the house and you are trying to give it up, you're going to go to the cigarettes very quickly and you're going to be smoking again before you know it. So one of the tricks of kind of giving up addictions is to actually know your problem and to make it difficult for yourself to kind of break a good habit or a good way of doing things. So if you are addicted to cigarettes, you put yourself outside of the kind of range of cigarettes. And if you have problems with eating too much, you put yourself out of range of that food to make it more difficult to get hold of it. That is often can often be a way of dealing with these things. It's one of those things about willpower. Willpower is generally considered to be very weak. We tend to kind of give in very easily. You're supposed to not eat certain things. The only way you can really do that is by being wise about it, to avoid those things, to make them inaccessible to you. That's usually the way to make these things work. Make things more, make it more difficult for you to get hold of those things, of food that is going to be difficult for you. But usually, addiction usually stops once you find another purpose in life. If you find some deeper purpose, then addiction often tends to end because of that. So, as you are practicing the path, you're practicing kindness, you're doing the right thing, and gradually that will take over the purpose of life, and addiction to food will actually slowly reduce and slowly disappear, hopefully altogether. In the meantime, just make it difficult for yourself to get hold of that food, and then you hopefully you will be able to kind of reduce it. Apart from that, you may want to go and see a counselor, if it is really obsessive. See if you can find someone who kind of has some experience with these things. Sometimes monks may not be the best people to kind of help you with these kind of addictions. So seeing a counselor can often be useful. Someone who has some experience with food addictions or whatever addiction it is that you have can often be a positive thing to do as well, because they understand how these things work, hopefully. Okay, maybe not all that useful, but hopefully a little bit useful to see what it does for you now. Okay. Dear Ajahn Brahmali, could the reference to acting in full awareness when falling asleep to waking up not be meant to be translated more precisely to acting in full awareness when dreaming in the sleeping state? Refer to maintaining lucidity when dreaming. i.e. lucid dreaming, in order to guide and develop the path. Also when dreaming, lucid dreaming is possible, and some traditions interpret this way. It also makes sense, question mark. Maybe, I don't think there is any reference to lucid dreaming anywhere in the suttas. Sutta means actually asleep, it doesn't mean dreaming. There are other words for dreaming, and there's no reference to dreaming in this particular case. So I think it is more likely to mean just, you know, that you are when you are asleep, and that you know the kind of the right amount and that sort of thing. I think that is more likely to be the meaning here. Simply because there is no reference to it anywhere else, as far as I know. There's nothing in the commentaries about this or anything like that. So anyway, that's my personal feeling about it. I doubt that very much. Anyway, but it's interesting, isn't it, lucid dreaming? I think many people have those experiences. I have them myself, and it's kind of interesting sometimes. So. Anyway, hi Ajahn, is there guidance on keeping celibacy here? And masturbation and sensual fantasy, thank you. Any guidance on that then? Well, the guidance is simply to, basically, you have to see the problems in these sensual pleasures, why they are difficult, and why they cause problems, and why craving is, there's always a lot of craving involved with these things, a lot of kind of restlessness, and the mind being agitated, etc., etc. So what you have to do, you have to see the alternative. And the alternative is a peaceful mind, a mind which is at ease and relaxed, and actually it is far preferable once you kind of get the hang of it. But again, so this is kind of the main thing. The other thing is to sort of do things that don't stimulate that kind of thinking. I'm sure you can think of what that would be in a number of ways. And then this is one of the great things about living in the forest as a monastic. You're far away from the sensuality of the world. It's very little to stimulate that kind of thinking. It is very useful because after a while it kind of tends to fade away. Not always, but usually it fades away as a consequence of that. But really it comes down to understanding where real happiness is to be found and where there are problems. I'm going to talk more about this tomorrow, because then we come to the ideas of sensuality and why they are problematic. So hopefully that will help you. But do it slowly. Don't kind of have too high expectations. It takes a long time to wean yourself off these things, because these are very, powerful, common ways of seeking pleasure in the world. So it takes a long time to kind of get over that. The Buddha himself says that, you deal with anger and ill will first of all, because anger and ill will is easy to get over, and it is very harmful. Sensuality is difficult to overcome, and it's nowhere near as harmful as anger. So don't worry too much about it. As you develop positive qualities of mind, you have less anger in your life, you have more metta and compassion, the compulsion to all of these other kind of pleasures will also be reduced. Because very often, like talking about food addiction before, or whatever it is that we're addicted to, very often we are addicted to these things because we have some kind of problem in our lives, some kind of suffering. The less suffering that you have in your life, the less you will have of these compulsions and addictions. Addictions is often a response to suffering. It's actually found in the suttas. The Buddha says specifically that for an ordinary person, they don't know any escape from suffering apart from sensual pleasures. So if you are suffering, you go to the sensual pleasures to escape from suffering in your life. So the less suffering you have, the more contented you are, the more you kind of live in a good way, you do a bit of metta meditation, these urges will tend to be reduced as a consequence. Okay. Dear Ajahn, I favor the lying down posture for meditation. Okay, good. It is good as it is pleasant and relaxing. Also, I practice faithfully and consistently. However, I do drop off to sleep, so I find the progress, if indeed there is any, extremely slow. Okay. Should I persevere with metta? It depends. Yeah, it really depends. It depends on the whether you are, whether it is working for you at all. And if you fall asleep all the time, then you might want to try a different posture. And if it occasionally works, then maybe what you should do is investigate when it works for you, and when it doesn't work, do something else. And when it works, then lie down. Sometimes it can be good to start by just relaxing in an ordinary way, yeah? Just doing something which takes you gradually down, makes you gradually more peaceful, until you have a certain degree of mindfulness, and then you can lie down. It takes a lot of mindfulness to be able to lie down and do your meditation. I know some people who can do it really well, but many people struggle with it. So you have to just test, try out, and see what happens. And if you, as you say, progress is very slow, nothing really happening, then try other postures as well. Try sitting on a chair, sitting leaning against the wall, whatever it is that works. So it's really about experimenting a little bit. That's what it comes down to. But if you only drift off sometimes and you fall asleep for a while and then you wake up and you are sharp again afterwards, then it's fine. I know one of my monastic friends, every time he sits down to do meditation, he nods off first of all. Yeah, kind of nods off, and he nods off for about 10 or 15 minutes. Then he becomes sharp, the mindfulness comes back, and then he goes into deep meditation afterwards. So it's all about your overall, you know, overall, whether it works for you or not. That's the important thing, really. Okay. Dearest Ajahn, is it wrong to fancy a monk? Okay. Now that is that is an awkward question, isn't it? It's important. What you do, you know what these things are like, yeah? You fancy somebody, these things just happen. Nothing you can really do about that. What is wrong is if you pursue somebody who is living the monastic life and you pull them out of the monastic life, that would be a wrong thing to do. But if you kind of like someone for a while and then kind of it disappears again very quickly. If you like someone for a while and it disappears, it's just life. It's just the way things are. And it's unavoidable. So that's not really a problem. But if you do it to the point where kind of it becomes, bad, then of course it is a problem. Okay. So anyway, dear Ajahn, let's go to the next one. The conditional construct, also known as I, is very good at doing, including thinking. It is unfortunately not as good at doing nothing. Please advise on how to practice doing nothing. Thank you, Vimeta. Indeed, and one of the reasons why the construct I is so good at doing things is because we identify with the doing. We think we are the doer. And if you think you are the doer, whenever you do things, what that means is that you gratify the sense of I. Yeah, if you are the doer, you gratify the sense of I. So it feels really nice to do things. And you see many people in the world, they are compulsive doers. Yeah, they do and do and do precisely because it kind of gratifies who they are. And this happens also in monastic life. So one of the things that you have to do to kind of get rid of that to some extent is to actually notice in your meditation, the more peaceful you are, usually the better you feel about yourself. The less doing there is, actually the sense of ease there. You start to understand that doing is actually a kind of irritation in the mind. The less you do, the better it is. Yeah, so notice the distinction. And this is really where the insight comes from, the understanding of where happiness really lies, and where dukkha lies. Then things kind of, you know, calm down, and they become better, and you understand the doing actually is a problem. This is really, really the way to do that. Everything really comes through experience in this way, and then you are, you should be on the right track. So, the way to practice doing nothing really has a lot to do with this thing that we were talking about before, about being a passenger on the train. Yeah, so you sit back, you are a passenger, you learn to be passive, you learn just to enjoy the scenery without getting involved. And as you do that, it becomes very nice after a while. Sometimes just being mindful and just watching and allowing things to kind of, pass by in a sense, that in itself already is actually a very pleasant experience. Because you have that compulsion to do, it's kind of taken out of it. And then you start to understand why doing actually is a problem. So, yeah, see what that does to you and see what happens. Okay. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, when I meditate, my perception of time gets distorted. Indeed, that's very, very common. When you meditate together with us or another group, how do you manage to find the exact time when to stop the meditation? You don't have to find that. It's not important when you stop. It doesn't really matter so much. Sometimes with a bit of experience, often you know pretty much, you know, what is the right amount. If you want to sit for an hour, you can almost feel when the hour is up. You open your eyes and bang, exactly an hour has passed by. Because it's almost as if you become very good at judging time when your mind becomes peaceful. But don't find a particular length of time for sitting. Sit in the length that seems right to you. What feels right. So go with the feeling, and as you go with the feeling, often what you find, as I was saying before, the meditation improves, it gets better and better and better, and there comes a point when it plateaus. Like you reach a kind of a point where it doesn't go any further, you stay there for a while, and sometimes it's almost as if the mind naturally exits from the meditation. Not everybody has this experience, but this is a fairly common experience. So just go with the flow, go with the natural rhythm of things. Feel the rhythm of the mind. The mind has a natural way of kind of going through a certain cycle. Follow the natural cycle of the mind. And when you do that, it's actually very easy. It's very natural. Don't worry about the other people. Just feel what works for you. And if that doesn't work, if you want to sit a particular amount of time, of course, you can always use a clock if you wish. I wouldn't really recommend that. I would forget about clocks altogether if I were you. I would rather just go with it. Try to go with the flow if you can. Sometimes also, if the meditation isn't going so well, you're trying to sit down, you just feel restless and nothing really works. After you've tried for a few minutes, 10 minutes or whatever, you just get up and walk out if it doesn't work for you. Sometimes the mind is like that. And then maybe sometimes during the day when things aren't more natural for you, it's easy for you to meditate. So meditate at those times. And don't worry so much about the other times. Now this way, you encourage yourself in the right way to find what is kind of suitable. Try to go with the flow, the natural rhythms of things. And then it becomes much more natural, easy, pleasant. And all of these positive perceptions tend to arise as a consequence of that. Okay. The first time I heard and read about Buddhist cosmology, I was blown away. Please give a brief overview of it to share amongst us retreatants. Kindly consider dedicating a future retreat to Buddhist cosmology in the context of the Noble Eightfold Path. Okay, then there's all these stars and planets and things and galaxies drawn on the little note, which is kind of cute. So Buddhist cosmology. Buddhist cosmology is often different ways of regarding Buddhist cosmology. One of the standard ways of thinking about Buddhist cosmology is the various planes of existence. You get reborn in that plane and up and down, all these kind of things. And it's kind of the standard idea of Buddhist cosmology. But what is also interesting in the suttas, and I gave a talk about this a while ago, it's on the BSWA, Dhammaloka website in Perth. So if you go there, you can find it. So I'll just refer you to that. I'll give you a quick summary now, perhaps. During that talk, I talked about the references to the universe made by the Buddha in the suttas. And some of the things that he talks about are quite remarkable. He talks about what looks like solar systems. When you have a sun, and you have the earth, and you have the moon. And he says there's thousands, billions of these units of sun, earth, and moon. It sounds like a solar system, and then there are beings attached to each one of these. So what the Buddha seems to say is that there's all these solar systems out there, and there are all these aliens, in the solar system. That's what he seems to be saying. And he talks about the number of solar systems as a thousand to the second power, a thousand to the third power. A thousand to the third power is a billion. Talk about billions of solar systems. This is quite literally what it says in the sutras. And then he talks about things like, you know, the evolution and the opposite of evolution. What is that? It's kind of the dissolution, perhaps, or involution, or something like that. Evolution and dissolution of what exactly? It's hard to know, but certainly he talks about vast mass expanses of time, when like the universe, the loka is like universe of the world, evolves and then contracts or then involves or whatever it is afterwards. It sounds like he's talking about the universe expanding and contracting. That's what it sounds like. And that's what most people interpret it to mean. Yeah, how did the Buddha know about these things? How can the Buddha have known about solar systems, about aliens? We don't even know about aliens yet. We're kind of heading in that direction. Yeah, people are seeing more, cosmologists are seeing more and more planets around. Some of those planets seem to be in the kind of habitable zone where there is possible to, might very well be life. We don't actually know this yet, but it seems very likely that we will discover alien life not too distant future. So what is going on here? How is the Buddha able to see these things? Actually, one other sutta I should mention, which is very interesting as well, is where the Buddha talks about the sun. And he talks about the sun going through different stages and becoming hotter and hotter and hotter until the earth burns up. Yeah, isn't that kind of astonishing? Because this is exactly what we know through modern cosmology, that the sun will eventually get hotter and hotter and hotter. It will expand until it swallows up the earth, and the earth will burn up. This is in the suttas. 2,500 years ago, the Buddha seems to have known about these things. So how is that possible that the Buddha could have known about these things? And I would say, for me, I don't think it is all that remarkable, but it would have been through remembering past lives, perhaps from, you know, the vantage point of a very high realm, and seeing kind of actually what is going on, seeing the universe expanding and contracting, seeing stars kind of blowing up, yeah, becoming large, and swallowing the planets or whatever in it. So he understood how the cosmos worked through memories of past lives. But what is also very interesting about this is that when the Buddha talks about cosmology in this way, he doesn't talk about it in just talking about cosmology. As you know, it's not as if cosmology in its own right is interesting or anything like that. That's not really what it is about. The reason Buddha talks about cosmology is because of impermanence. He tries to show impermanence on a very large scale. Then he says to the monks at the end of the suttas, well, you know, this is how impermanent things are. It is enough to be disenchanted or enough to be repelled by all conditioned phenomena. To lose your craving and desire and be liberated from all conditioned phenomena. That is what he's saying at the end there. So he's just using the cosmological details as an example of impermanence and the problem of impermanence and why we should be liberated from the worldly phenomena. This is not speculation. This is not something that has any value for him in its own right. It's kind of, you know, by the by, in a sense. Yeah, it's kind of just put in there. But once you see it, it's still really quite astonishing that the Buddha could have known, seems to have known about these things. That's what it looks like to me. Of course, you have to be careful. There's always a degree of interpretation, always a degree of, a scope for misunderstanding. But it seems pretty clear. You know, it's not as if the Pali is very complicated or anything like that. It's kind of straightforward to interpret, I would say. So if you are interested, there is a wrote I edited this talk I gave and made it into a little booklet. And that booklet is also available online, so if you want to check it out, you can read it there. There's many more details in this little booklet, if you're interested. But whether I will ever incorporate this in a future retreat, maybe I will. Some of the simple suttas are actually actually quite nice, so maybe that's a good point. So thank you for that suggestion. Okay. Dear Ajahn, could you explain the concept of emptiness, please? Thank you. Yes. The idea of emptiness, it means different things depending on the kind of type of Buddhism that you are looking at. Yeah, so Theravada Buddhism or the Pali Buddhism, emptiness has kind of one meaning. And in later Buddhism, Vajrayana, Mahayana Buddhism, it means something slightly different. And I can't really tell you exactly what it means in Mahayana Buddhism, but there the concept is expanded to become much more broad, encompassing many more things. But in Theravada Buddhism, the idea of emptiness is basically synonymous with the idea of non-self. There is nothing inherent in a human being or any being. There's nothing there which is the kind of the final analysis of who you are as a person. There is no such thing. So you are empty of a self. You are empty of inherent essence. That is what it means. That is kind of the main idea in the suttas. Emptiness of a self, emptiness of anything belonging to a self. But there's also the idea of using emptiness in your meditation practice. Yeah, seeing things as empty. And this is found in a couple of suttas in the Majjhima Nikaya. Majjhima Nikaya, the shorter sutta on emptiness, the Chulasunyata Sutta, it is found in there. And in that sutta, it says that what you do is you focus on what is absent in your perception. Yeah, so you focus on, for example, you are doing whatever meditation you are doing. You see that as you focus on the meditation subject, things are emptying out. And sometimes it's very useful to think like that. You know, you come here, you sit down in this beautiful place here in the Peak District. I've never been here before. I'm very glad I was invited to come here. Otherwise, I would have missed out. Yes? So thank you very much, Venerable Chanda, for inviting me here. It's really quite nice to be here. So, but what is absent here? Quite a few things are absent here. Big cities is absent. You know, traffic noise is largely absent. A lot of the problems, ordinary problems in life, are absent. And notice an absence, and notice how nice it is when these things fade away and they're not there. You're already, if you notice that, you're already kind of leaning towards, meditation, peace, and all of these kind of things. So each step in your meditation, notice what's absent. When you come on a retreat like this, you are away from your work. You're away from your family. You're away from your usual duties. And this place here, it's so nice. They make all the food for us to do everything. We don't have to do anything. Most retreat centers, you have to do a little few things. Here, you can mostly just relax. You're empty of all of those things. And notice the pleasure of that, of being away from things in your life, of having not having those responsibilities, those burdens kind of looming over you that you have to look after. When the breath starts to become more, you become even more peaceful. All you have left in your mind is the breath. The five senses are starting to calm down. The body is starting to disappear. You are emptying that out as well. And you notice the emptiness when those things are gone, what is absent. And by noticing what is absent, you start to understand how things disappearing, how simplicity is a very positive and nice thing. And you keep on doing that until eventually, everything is gone. Complete emptiness. When you reach, according to the suttas, the highest happiness, according to the suttas, is when everything is gone. Sanya, Vidalita, Niroda, the cessation of perception and feeling, that is the highest kind of happiness, according to the Bahuvedana Sutta, Majjhima Nikaya 59, I think it is. If you go there, that is what you find. So this is how to think about, two ways of how to think about emptiness. According to the Buddhist teachings of the Pali Canon. Okay. Okay, dear Bhante, Majjhima Nikaya 27 is quite radical in its implications. Yes, indeed. Most many suttas are really radical in implications. That's precisely right. How should we relate to an object of the senses in the light of not grasping at its silent features? Is it permissible to smell a rose, listen to a bird song, eat some cake, and enjoy these things? Or must we develop strong enough mindfulness through all our sense impressions to the extent of only witnessing phenomena with bare attention? Bare attention. You have written bear as in teddy bear. Are you aware of that? I'm not sure if you're aware of that, but that's what you have. And this is Ajahn Brahm's latest book. It's called Bear Attention. B-E-A-R. You can have a nice teddy bear on the cover. And the reason why we have that is because if you come to our retreat center in Perth, we have all these teddy bears in our retreat center. it's a very kind of cozy retreat centers. And after a while, when the retreatants kind of get a bit despondent because the meditation isn't going as well as it's supposed to be, you find them sitting with a teddy bear either next to them or a teddy bear in their lap. You have to kind of comfort them a little bit there. It's kind of nice. It creates a nice atmosphere when you have teddy bears in the meditation center. Everybody kind of relaxes a little bit more there. So that's why you put bear attention either that or you, I'm not sure whether you did that on purpose or not, but it's quite nice anyway. Clear comprehension and without papancha. Ajahn Brahm says to the bird on the wing, to kiss the bird on the wing. Okay, does he really? I've never heard before then. To kiss the bird, okay. Find the honey in the moment. Okay, yes, that's exactly right. Then how does this fit? Then? Thank you. Okay, so the point here, yeah, and this is where you have to be careful. It's important not to be too radical about these things. And remember that the way that you overcome these things is in stages. So it's always about doing the things that are the most problematic in the beginning. That's what you deal with. So you deal with those sense impressions that are really draw you away from the present moment the most. That is the most important things to deal with. So don't worry so much about the bird song. Yeah, the bird song is not going to be a major problem. Smelling the rose is not going to be a major problem for you. In fact, enjoy those things. Enjoy the little things in life like that, because you're not going to have a massive craving for those kind of things. It's going to be so subtle types of craving with these little things. So focus on the big things when you feel your mind really gets dragged away, yeah, and really gets dragged into things, and other things to focus on first of all. And then you will notice in your meditation practice, you will usually notice where your problems are, because your mind will tend to hang out in certain places. Yeah, your mind will tend to go, if your meditation isn't going so well, where does your mind go to? What are the things that you think about? And those things that you tend to come back to all the time, that is where your problems are. Because that is like your existence, that's where you're going to hang out. That is kind of what your mind is clinging to some extent. And so deal with those issues that are really problematic. If you go and smell the rose and then you think about the rose for the rest of the day, then you have a problem with smelling the rose. Yeah? But usually that doesn't happen. You smell the rose and you forget about it pretty quickly afterwards. Okay, it's nice, but it only lasts a very short time, and then you kind of move on. So eat some cake. Please eat some cake. Yeah, it's important to eat some cake. Yeah, I think that's we do that as monks as well. And I say that, you know, why do monks enjoy their food? We do enjoy our food. Yeah, I certainly enjoy my food. I don't know about Venerable Chanda, maybe she is more enlightened than I am, but I certainly enjoy my food. And the thing is that it's only a problem if I go back to my kuti in the forest in the afternoon and I continue thinking about food all afternoon. Then it is a problem when I think about it in the evening. But if I just enjoy my food while I eat it and then I forget it afterwards, it's not an issue. No? That's what I find in my life. I don't usually think about food at all, actually. Yeah. And that's obviously because we get pretty good, well-fed in our world, and that's probably the reason. food really becomes a problem when you get hungry. That's when it really becomes a problem. So again, just notice how these things affect you. And if it doesn't drag on and it doesn't kind of stick in your consciousness, it's not really a problem. Yeah, so ideally, you're right, you know, gradually you move towards more bare attention, but without the papancha, but don't put the bar, set the bar too high, otherwise you're going to be disappointed with yourself. Find that kind of balance where you enjoy life, but you don't make life kind of unbearable. And then gradually, you move in the right direction. It's so important to do that. There's a tendency among serious Buddhists to kind of be too serious. Yeah, have no joy, make it so dry, yeah, be really serious about things. But I have always found that the best, the most inspiring teacher, the most inspiring monastic, the most inspiring lay Buddhist, they are joyful, they are happy, yeah. They kind of exude a sense of being content with life, being very light-hearted. It's one of the things that is so beautiful about Ajahn Brahm, so light-hearted. the reason why I tell so many stories and jokes is not because he's always silly, it's because he's light-hearted. That's why he does that. Yeah? So you have to see these things in the right context. Remember that. It's important to find that balance where you can have a light heart and not be too, get too serious about things. Okay. The answer, who are these Arahants? That is a very good question, okay? Have you met one? Where are they? Thank you for your kind heart and teaching. This is something you have to figure out for yourself. I cannot tell you where the Arahants are or who they are. Have I met any Arahants? The problem is it's very difficult to know whether you have met an Arahant or not. Yeah, I know that I have met some very inspiring people, some people who have the characteristics who might be Arahants, yeah? But it's very difficult to know whether they actually are Arahants or not. You have to do the same thing. You have to look at people, and you have to look at them, whether they have the characteristics that make them inspiring or not. Don't worry too much about whether they are Arahants or not. Just worry about whether they have the characteristics whereby it is you can place confidence in them. Yeah, that is what is important. So look at them. Are they well-behaved? Are they doing the right thing? They're not showing too many defilements or any defilements ideally. And then you can have a degree of confidence in these people. And don't try too hard to figure out who is an Arahant or who is not. As long as they have the right characteristics, then you are you're not going to go too far astray with those people. But there's always one Arahant around. Yeah, there's always one Arahant that you always can rely on, and that is the Buddha. Yeah, so there's always one Arahant there. So go back to that Arahant first of all, the Buddha Arahant. And find your main inspiration from there. And then the other Arahants, they are a bit more uncertain. The Buddha Arahant is certain. Well, either he's certain or the whole thing falls apart. And the other Arahants, they are more not so sure. But it is nice. I must admit, it is nice sometimes to meet people who are very inspiring and seeing how they live and how they do things. One of the monks I like quite a lot is a monk called Ajahn Kanha. He's a very close friend of Ajahn Brahm, by the way. But he lives in Thailand. He's been to Bodhidharma Monastery a few times. He's kind of always smiling, always happy, always kind of serene. Is he an Arahant? Well, this is the story, yeah? I'm not sure if I'm supposed to tell this story, but I'll tell it anyway. Because I know Ajahn Brahm tells it sometimes. But the story of Ajahn Kanha is as follows, yeah? I don't really fully understand this story myself, but anyway, this is how it goes. So, this is in Thailand. This would have been when Ajahn Brahm was still there in Thailand. So this would be 35 years ago or something. And all the monks are present. Ajahn Shah is there. This is before he became ill and all of these things. And all the monks were there. And then Ajahn Shah asks the monks, this is kind of the weird thing. He asks the monks, is there any one of you who is free from defilements? Kind of strange question, isn't it? Is there any one of you who is free from defilements? And then there's one monk who lifts his hand. Yeah, one monk. Which is that monk? That's Ajahn Kanha. He lifts his hand. Yes, I'm free of defilements. And it's kind of strange. And then Ajahn Chah said, okay, come up to my kuti. Ajahn Chah had his kuti, and he kind of was living on the top, and on the bottom was like a meeting place where everybody would come together. So we would take Ajahn Kanha to the top, and I don't know how this information got out. He was probably asked by his fellow monks afterwards what Ajahn Shah told him. So then Ajahn Shah apparently told him, if you have finished your defilements, you're an Arahant now, your job now is to have metta towards people. Why? Because if you're an Arahant, your job is to have compassion for the world, to help others on the spiritual path. That's really all that remains for an Arahant to do. So metta here just means metta in action, how you deal with people around you. And this is why Ajahn Kanha is famous for his metta, because that is exactly what he has been doing over the last 35 years. He must have been very young when he had these kind of big realizations. So when you go to his monastery, you find this blob of metta, sitting there. And he's kind of quite big, sits on this big chair. And he's just one big smile. It's like this kind of one big smile sitting on this chair. He doesn't say anything. He just sits there. And people come, they bow down to him, and they kind of sit down next to him because it feels so nice to sit down next to him. He doesn't need to say anything. this is kind of Ajahn-Kanha. So is he arahant? I don't actually know, but according to that story, it certainly seems possible. So there you are. So you find your own arahant, and then that will be more powerful for you. Okay, this is the last question from yesterday. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, during my breath meditation, I notice a tension builds up in my mind, like expanding and then releasing it. Is this supposed to happen? This continues for some time, and I also feel like some energy moving up my spine, making it erect. What is the cause of all this, sir? Thank you, ma'am. The cause of all this is, it can be many things. It is difficult to be, absolutely sure what is going on. If you have tension in your mind, sometimes the tension comes from too much willpower. Willpower is a very subtle thing, and sometimes it's very hard to know that you're using too much willpower in your meditation. It's very difficult to see sometimes, because you just feel that you are staying naturally with the breath, yeah? But actually, there's a subtle willpower very often, a subtle agency behind that very often. And that can lead to tension if you keep on doing it for a long time. And then maybe you relax the willpower a little bit, the tension disappears, and then maybe it comes and goes a little bit like that. That is likely to be the most likely explanation, that that is what's going on. But it's not necessarily the case. Tension can also just be a perception that arises in you. I mentioned yesterday the idea that in meditation practice, it's very common for all kinds of perceptions to come and go. All kind of weird things may happen. Your body expanding, your body contracting, your body levitating, all of this. And this is also a very common thing. So it could be that as well. But I would, most likely, it is a little bit too much willpower. Energy moving up the spine, again, that is very likely just to be a perception. You perceive the energy going up. And as long as it is a good feeling, as long as you feel happy with it, that energy could be a sign of joy, it could be a sign of piti, because that often feels like energy in the body, but a very nice kind of energy, an energy which is combined with joy, combined with kind of a thrill almost feeling, feeling in the body, and it's actually very positive. So focus on whether the mind is pure or not, whether the mind is in a good state, that you don't have any defilements in the mind. The defilements are usually a sign that the mind is going astray. If you feel a bit deluded, you feel a bit angry or whatever, that is usually a very negative sign in meditation. That's where you have to be careful. But if your mind is in a good space, you have good qualities there, you have mindfulness, things are going well, you don't really have much to worry about. But try to just to relax a little bit more, try not to focus too hard, and maybe those tensions in the head will also disappear as a consequence. Okay, so now we come to today's questions. Dear Ajahn, please explain the details of watching one's breath. Does one follow the breath from the tip of the nostrils all the way and vice versa? I have difficulty in concentrating on the breath. Okay, so the reason why you have difficulty is not because you are focusing on the breath in the wrong way. Yeah, that is not the reason. And the reason why it is difficult is usually because your mindfulness is not sharp enough yet. That is usually the reason. So if your mindfulness isn't sharp enough and you find it hard to follow the breath, do something else until the mindfulness becomes sharper. You can do a bit of metta meditation if you want. You can do some walking meditation. And then come back to the breath occasionally to see if the mindfulness is sharp enough to stay with it. That is the problem. One of the things that you see, and we're going to have a look at the Anapanasati Sutta later on, the Sutta on Mindfulness of Breathing. And one of the things it says in there, having established mindfulness, then you watch the breath. So the sequence is so important. So if you cannot watch the breath, usually it means that you're not ready for it. There's no point in just applying more force. There's no point in counting forwards and backwards. There's no point in trying to look for all the little bits and pieces in between, because all you're doing is using force and willpower to try to stay with it. It should be fairly natural. The breath is just there and you're just following it because it feels pleasant, it feels nice. Yeah, that is kind of the idea behind this. So, I'm not going to say much more because we're going to focus, have a look at the Anapanasati Sutta later on. It's a very beautiful sutta, very inspiring, and I hope to go through that in quite a bit of detail. But it will be one of the last things we're going to be doing on this retreat. So maybe on Saturday, perhaps, or something like that. Okay, dear Adramamali, thank you for explaining the sutta so well and meaningfully. Where can I find your explanation of other suttas? Also, have you written any Dhamma books? And so, where can I buy them from? Thank you. I don't write very much. I'm not kind of much of a writer. But what you can do is that you can go online, go to the Buddhist Society of Western Australia website, and you will find lots of suttas on that website. So go to bsw.org, yeah, and you find heaps of sutta explanations there, which I have done, that Ajahn Brahm have done, that many others have done as well. Have I written any Dhamma? Actually, where is Surangani? Over there, okay. She has brought one Dhamma book, which all my Dhamma books are really based on talks that I gave a long time ago, and they're kind of written out and edited a bit. And this is one on a couple of talks on dependent origination and dependent liberation. So that book she has brought here. So at the end of the retreat, we'll hand out one book to every retreat. Doesn't mean you have to take it. If you don't like to read one of the books, you're not forced to. Yeah. So only if you want it, do you have to. Should you take it? But for that person who wrote that note, it is specially for you. Yeah. So this is this must be your good karma, perhaps, or something. Yeah. There's also another book which you may enjoy, which is not about the suttas, that I wrote together with Ajahn Sujato, called The Authenticity of the Early Buddhist Texts. But that is more about how we know which texts are early and these kind of things. It is a bit more academic, to be honest with you, and not kind of as inspiring, but some of you may enjoy that book as well. It's available online. So check that out as well if you are interested. Okay, dear Ajahn Brahmani, can you tell me about the newly launched Sutta Central compiled by you and Ajahn Sujato? Are there these suttas explained like you are doing to the suttas on this retreat, or are there only translations from the Pali? How can we get to this channel? Thank you. You just go to suttacentral.net. Straight away you find it online, suttacentral.net. It's actually a very good resource, Sutta Central, because what you have, first of all, you have the suttas translated by Bhante Sujato, and I have translated the Vinaya, which is not as interesting. He took the interesting part, that's really unfair. I have translated the Vinaya. No, I don't mind at all, actually. So sometimes you have to kind of divide the labor in certain ways. The suttas are then linked up to all kinds of things, linked up to discussions about them, linked up to AV material, audiovisual material, like talks and all these kind of things. So when you go to a particular sutta and you click on the right bar or whatever it is, you can get access to all the things that are linked to that, which will be talks and everything. And I think most of my talks and many other people's talks have actually been linked up to the individual suttas on Sutta Central. I'm not sure exactly how it works because I don't actually hang out there all that much. But if you go there and you check it out, you should be able to find a lot of things on Sutta Central. But mostly it is translations. The translations done by Ajahn Sujato are very modern. They're very contemporary English language. Not too contemporary. Not kind of street language or anything like that. But reasonably contemporary language, and that makes it quite accessible. A lot of translations are often hard to read. If you kind of read, pick your Bodhi's translation, sometimes it uses long sentences and completely incomprehensible vocabulary, like volitional formations, and nobody knows what it means, except if you think, you sit down and think about it for long periods of time, you may figure it out. So he has made it much more accessible, more simple, more easy to understand. And these days, a lot of people who read the suttas, they read as, they have English as a second language. I'm one of those. Well, these days, English is getting more and more my first language, but it used to be my second language. But because a lot of people have it as a second language, it means that you have to have it simple, yeah? And the majority of English speakers in the world today actually have English as a second language rather than the first language. So there's a vast number of people who want to be able to read the sutta in a simple way like that. And this is one of the very good reasons for keeping it simple. So check it out. It's a great resource. The reason why Ajahn Sujata ended up translating the suttas, what he actually wanted to do was to take Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi's translations and put them all online. So he wrote to Wisdom Publications of all the copyright. Yeah, the copyright of suttas, is that right? Should people be allowed to have copyright of the word of the Buddha? The word of the Buddha was given for free to humanity for us to enjoy, to use. And then we copyright it, is that right? It's not really right, is it? It's terrible that it should be copyrighted in this way. But of course, the reason why it is done is because there are expenses to do with translation, all these things. So to recoup some of those expenses, you don't have a copyright to do that. So it's not entirely entirely bad, but it is a bit unfortunate that something has been given free to humanity should be copyrighted in that way and not enable people just to read it just like that. So Wisdom Publications, they refused to kind of free those texts and make them available online, even though they already had recouped their money a long time ago. Still, they refused to do that. That's why he said, okay, there's only one thing to do, and that is I have to translate them myself. And that's how he ended up translating suttas for the last 2.5 years. So I hope that helps. And if it doesn't, then ask me again. Dear Ajahn, thank you for your guidance and inspiration. I'm taking away a great discovery from this retreat. I realize that my resentments and inner commentary about others, and equally my resentments and inner commentary about myself, are almost entirely due to those things in me that I cannot accept or forgive. Yes, good. So that's great. So that's a wonderful realization already. That's really excellent. I have been struggling with self-sabotage in my meditation during this retreat, but today I did an effort to practice forgiveness for myself and for what I have done towards others, and sadhu sadhu, my meditation came along finally without sabotage. Okay, that is wonderful, that is exactly right. It is about accepting oneself, accepting one's faults, accepting that you're not going to be perfect, and that when you accept and you forgive together, and then you kind of you are okay, you find out that you are okay. That is exactly when things tend to come together. So that's great. So I'm very happy to hear that. Okay. Dear Ajahn, right view is the first in the Noble Eightfold Path. To gain right view, is it through reading the suttas or Dhamma books or through meditation practice? To gain an understanding, do you have to do some reading first so that you have a clear understanding of the goal of the path? Or does your understanding become clear through the meditation practice? Also, by leaving a clear view or understanding of the Dhamma, does that automatically lead to right thought, the second noble factor of the Noble Eightfold Path? Is it through that that thought is important at death as an understanding, if it is the last thought on the death that determines your next rebirth? Also, in regard to good Dhamma books, can I please recommend any books, good books, reliable Dhamma books, to gain knowledge of the true Dhamma? Thank you. Okay, that's a lot, so let's kind of start. Let's go back to the beginning. I've already forgotten what you said at the beginning, so let's go back to the start. So do you gain a right view by reading the sutta? Yes, that's exactly right. And in a sense, you could say that the four Nikayas, or all the teachings of the Buddha, they are exactly what right view is. So whenever you open the suttas and you read, you are getting brainwashed by right view. And Dhamma books is more, not as reliable. It depends who has written those books. Yeah, if it's written by the Buddha, you can be absolutely, you know, usually it's going to be good, obviously. If it's written by someone else, uncertain. So this is where you have to be careful. If you trust somebody because you know them fairly well, whatever it is, then you can often perhaps trust the Dhamma as well in the Dhamma books. But generally, be a little bit careful with that. It's much better to go back to the source. Much better to listen to somebody who actually talks about the suttas, because then you have at least some reference. There's some anchoring point, which is the sutta itself. A talk that is entirely free-floating without any reference to the suttas, it's much more difficult to know what people are talking about often. It's one of those interesting things that I have kind of took me a long time to discover. But people sometimes think that it is far easier to understand a contemporary Dhamma book written by, you know, somebody, anyone apart from the Buddha. Think, oh, it's so easy to understand. Yeah, the language is modern, it flows very nice, and all this kind of thing. But the suttas are so boring by comparison. But actually, if you really get into trying to understand what a modern contemporary teacher says, especially about deep Dhamma things, often it is not very clear at all. Often it is very confusing. You try to people talk about all kind of weird, use all kind of weird concepts that may seem easy to understand on the surface, but when you actually look a bit further, it's not clear at all what they're referring to. And so. Be careful with that. Whereas when you go to the suttas and you look at how the Buddha talks about things, it often is very integrated, it is very clear, it is very rational. Actually, I would say the suttas tend to be far more easy to understand overall than most contemporary writings, in my opinion. The language is not as polished because it's ancient language. The language is not as, it's not perhaps as flowing and all that. But in terms of actually understanding the content and getting the right view, it is far preferable. That is my experience. I'm not saying you should never read any modern contemporary things on Buddhism. Of course, you should do that, but make sure that you have take your final refuge in the right place. Meditation practice, of course, that is a very important part of it. So you read the suttas, you meditate, and the two together is what often kind of brings you forward. You meditate, and then you read the suttas in terms of meditation, and you interpret the suttas in terms of meditation and vice versa, both ways. So do them together. Yeah, read and meditate together. That's kind of the ideal way. And they tend to come. This is what we're trying to do here on this retreat. And often it's a very nice combination that works really well now. Ultimately, it is true that your understanding becomes clear through meditation practice. Yeah? In the final analysis, that is exactly what happens. Right view leads to right thought, the second factor of the Noble Path. Yes, I prefer to call it right aim, or right goal, or right purpose, rather than right thought. Sankappa means like plan. It is a word very closely related to Chaitanya. Chaitanya means intention, yeah? Very closely related to that. So it has to do with planning, intentioning, purpose, goal, where we're heading. That is my understanding of that. So yes, it leads automatically. Why? Because when you have the right view, what you're having the right view about is where happiness and where suffering is to be found. If you understand that morality is important for your own happiness, you're going to become more moral, yeah? Right view leads to right action, right speech, and then meditation practice and all these kind of things. So right view always will inform the rest of the path. That is why it is so important to get it right. The last thought moment at death that determines your next rebirth. Well, I don't really agree with that. And there is nothing really in the suttas to say that is the case. This idea of the last thought moment and deciding your rebirth is really something that comes from the Abhidhamma and from the commentaries on the Abhidhamma and how that is expounded. And the reason why the last thought moment is so important according to the Abhidhamma is because according to the Theravada system, there is no intermediate existence. Yeah, when you die, you get reborn straight away. You die, and bang, you're reborn straight away into a new existence. There's nothing in between that. And of course, if that is the case, then your last moment is going to have a very powerful effect on the next moment, which is your rebirth. And this is where I think this idea comes from, that your last thought moment is so important, because they have taken out the idea of an intermediate state. But I think it is fairly clear from the suttas, the way the Buddha talks, that there is such a thing as an intermediate state. So you die, yeah, then you go into this intermediate state where you have, you may have a life review, and you may have all these kind of things happening in an intermediate state. And then kind of your karma sort of ripens over, takes a bit of time for it to ripen, and then you get reborn. And because it takes a bit of time, it may take a few days or whatever, because of that, your last thought moment doesn't matter that much. What matters is the accumulation of karma in your entire life, because that is what is going to decide what your mind state is like in that intermediate existence. And this is what the Buddha says everywhere. Yeah, it's always about your accumulated karma during your life that matters, not your last thought moment. And it becomes quite tricky if it is the last thought moment. You're trying to control your very things towards the end, yeah? Trying desperately to have the right mind state. It is not a very, I don't think it's a very good thing at all. I think it kind of, when you die, you want to be relaxed. You want to enjoy. You just want to kind of, okay, you don't want to try to control everything in this way. It just makes everything more difficult. So I think this last thought moment business is way over, it's something that we can basically forget about to a very large extent, not worry too much about. Can you recommend any good and reliable Dhamma books to gain knowledge about the true Dhamma? Well, you can try the long discourses of the Buddha, the middle-length discourses of the Buddha, the connected discourses of the Buddha, and the numerical discourses of the Buddha. Yeah, those are really good Dhamma books. I really recommend those. There are other books as well available, but you know, I would read the suttas if I were you. Listen to talks about the suttas. Go to the source. If you really don't like it, then you can try other books. If you don't like it, you can do other things. But you can read like Ajahn Brahm's books. I don't know if you like Ajahn Brahm's books. They're full of nice little stories and jokes and all these kind of things. Opening the door of your heart. And some of those stories in there are actually very profound and very beautiful. And people often kind of, they have a good laugh, but they forget to take away the message in those stories, which often actually, if you take away the message fully in those stories, you're going to go a long way on the Buddhist path. It's a very simple Dhamma book. It's very unintellectual. And this, I think, is a charm with Ajahn Brahm, is that he's not very intellectual. Yeah, he can be intellectual, but he doesn't kind of put on any intellectual airs. He just keeps it very simple and easy. It's for everyone. And that actually is a very positive thing, because it doesn't exclude people so much. Everybody can read Ajahn Brahm's books. So take those stories on board. Read them properly. Take away the message, not just the joke. Take away the take-home message. Practice accordingly, and you're going to go a long way. Opening the door of your heart. Bear awareness. Teddy bear awareness. Good Man Who Knows, that's another one of his books. And you can also read his meditation book, which is called Mindfulness, Bliss and Beyond, and whatever other books that are out there by Ajahn Brahm. I can't remember them all, there's so many of them there. The Art of Disappearing, that's a good one, that's true. Okay, I edited that one, so that's a nice one as well, actually. The Art of Disappearing, So check out Ajahn Brahm's books. I always recommend that. Let's go on to the next one. Dear Ajahn, considering our being conditioned, the idea of karma seems to be a bit unfair. For example, a person growing up in a mafia family would make lots of bad karma, which then leads to a vicious circle of being under bad circumstances and so on. Yes, that is exactly the problem. Yeah. So it kind of makes sense. Yeah. If you grow up in a mafia family, then you still go to prison if you do bad things. It doesn't mean that you kind of let off prison sentence just because you're born in the mafia family. You still have that problem. So, and the reason why you are there is obviously because of things in the past life, very often. You are attached to these people, you are attached, maybe you were attached to bad people in the past life, and then you get reborn with those same bad people in this life because of your attachments. So you have to attach to good people. This is one of the lessons here. So if you're going to attach to anyone, and we all have to attach a little bit, attach to good things. Attach a bit to the Buddha. Attach a bit to, you know, to something positive in your life. Attach a bit to being kind. Attach a bit to generosity. Attach a bit to the peace that you get in meditation. Don't attach too much, but a little bit. Why? Because you have to attach anyway. Attachment is not something you can choose away. Attachment is part and parcel of having a sense of self. As long as you have a sense of self, you're going to attach to some extent. So have a bit of attachment. Choose your attachments wisely so you do not get reborn in the mafia family in the next life. Yeah? Then you are on the right track. Yeah. So is it unfair? I think in the long run of things, when you look at things on the really long run, it probably isn't all that unfair, because you make bad choices on the way, you do silly things, whether those choices are conditioned or not, well, you know, whatever, in the long run, things usually tend to be reasonably fair. But sure, be aware of that, and understand how this works, and when you do that, when you have awareness of these things, you will make better choices yourself as a consequence. Okay, dear Ajahn Ramali, how can we overcome anger that is not directed against another person, but against unpleasant bodily and mental states, e.g. pain, unpleasant emotions? Thank you. Yes, well, the way to do that is that you have, you know, one of the most important things in life is to understand that all, not only other people, but everything in life tends to be conditioned. Yeah, so if you have a unpleasant mental state, to get angry with it makes it even more unpleasant. Yeah, and then you get angry with that, and then you get angry with that one again, and it kind of builds up infinitely, and you get infinite anger that way if you keep on thinking like that. So what you have to do is that you have to learn that anything, bodily experiences, mental pain, all of this is conditioned, it is non-self. So you learn to accept it for whatever it is. So if you have bodily pains and you can't do anything about it, if you can do something about it by getting up or by moving around or whatever, please do so. But if it is a chronic pain, you can't do anything about it, it's always there, and some people have that, then you're going to have to accept it. This is your life, it is like this. And if you always fight against something you cannot do anything with, then that's kind of, you understand, that's silly, because it just makes the whole process worse than it is already. So learning to accept what you can't do anything about is one of those fundamental things to have a better life. Yeah? Do something with those things you can do something about. Learn to accept those things you cannot do anything about. This is a very important kind of distinction. And if you can do that, then you are on the right track. Yeah? The same thing with your mental pain. Yeah? Sometimes you can't do anything about the mental pain because you're going through a rough period or whatever it is. You just have to bear with it. Okay, I'm going through a difficult period. I feel a bit depressed, or I feel a bit traumatized, or whatever it is. Okay, it's fine. And you let it be. And then you come out the other end as a better person as a consequence. So you learn to accept because you can't do anything about it. And when you do that, you're making less of a problem out of it. If you get angry with these things, it just makes it worse. Yeah, you're adding pain upon pain. That's kind of there's not much point to that. So it is kind of illogical in a sense. And if you use a sense of logic with these things, actually it tends to gradually, you start to see that you're doing something silly, and you're able to let go of it on that basis. See things as nature. Nature does its stuff. And because nature does its stuff, you're just going to have to accept that. Yeah. Okay. Dear Ajahn, is it possible for a householder to achieve full awakening? Is it possible? Maybe it's possible. I wouldn't worry too much about it, to be honest. I'm not sure exactly why you're asking this question, but I think often we get too kind of materialistic about spiritual things. Yeah, we want to become this, we want to do that. So don't worry too much about jhana, samadhi, awakening, all these kind of things. There's only one thing that you really need to worry about, and that is whether you are making progress on the path or not. That is the thing that matters. So if you go on a retreat 1 year, and then you go on the retreat a year later on, have you improved? Are you more mindful? Is your samadhi becoming any better? Are you feeling more kind? Are you feeling more relaxed than it is? Do you have less defilements? Do you have less problems? And if you see that this is what is happening, then you are on the right track. That's all that matters. Too often we are interested in experiences, but the individual experiences are often kind of meaningless. Yes, okay, you have one jhana experience, perhaps some people have that, they never have it again. And what that means is that instead of actually improving, you have one peak experience and it's all gone and nothing happens afterwards. That's kind of not the point. The point is to always head in the right direction. That's what you should worry about and what you should be concerned about. So don't think too much about these things, whether, you know, stream entry and enlightenment and these things. But I will reply to your question anyway, because the suttas do talk about these kind of things. And according to the suttas, you can be a lay person can be a stream entry, they can be all the way up to an anagami, a non-returner. And if you do become an arahant as a stream winner, what happens? If you do become as a lay person, you become an arahant, getting a bit tired now, I'm mangling my words. If you do become an arahant as a lay person, at that moment, you're no longer a lay person. You are already a monastic in your mind. Yeah? So you have given up the householdership the moment you become an arahant. And the reason for that is because as an arahant, you cannot really store things up in the way that householders do. You cannot kind of accumulate things. Householder life is about accumulating things a little bit. Yeah, furniture, all kind of stuff, and holding on to it as yours. An arahant, you don't have that perception anymore. So you have kind of given that up. So you can become an arahant as a lay person, but then as soon as you become arahant, basically you are a monastic already. Yeah, it's kind of nice, isn't it? So you can go all the way according to the suttas. But of course, once again, it is the Buddha did lay down the monastic path for a reason. That is because it is supposed to be the best vehicle for attaining this thing. So. Okay, dear Ajahn Brahmali, I think you and Ajahn Brahm have been born with very refined qualities. Okay, listening to you, it seems that you have found some things easy, which many of us wouldn't, certainly not me. If we are not so advanced as you and Ajahn Brahm, then we should just practice where we are at and persevere, ? Thank you. It's very hard to know where anyone is at. And be careful about projecting. Yeah, you can very easily project onto people and you think that someone is marvelous because they sit on a seat and they can give a talk for an hour. Then this must mean that they are really wonderful as a consequence. But it's not as simple as that. You don't really know me. You don't know me very well. And because of that, you always be a little bit careful with how you judge somebody. Yeah, when you know somebody really well, then you can judge them better. If you don't, it's much more difficult. So keep your eyes open and just keep on. Don't judge too quickly. That is what I would recommend you in all kinds of circumstances. Should we just persevere in the practice? That's exactly right. You always persevere, you always keep going. And this is why it is so useful to listen to a good Dhamma talk or read in the suttas or whatever, because this is the stuff which ultimately enables you to commit and persevere in the practice, yeah? And as long as you feel that you're making progress, as long as you feel that your mind is kind of improving in good qualities and declining in the bad ones, as long as that is happening, you're going to have a long life as a Buddhist. This one has kept me going for 25 years now, or whatever it is in monastic life. But the fact that I have felt this steady kind of progress all the time throughout my monastic life. And as long as you feel that, it feels incredibly meaningful. You feel that you really are heading somewhere. And it's kind of marvelous where this path is going. It's kind of more and more marvelous the further down the path you go. That is what is so wonderful about this. So you try to do the same thing. And if you find that you stagnate, that you don't improve in good qualities, you have to ask yourself why. And you have to be very honest with yourself and try to look at yourself objectively, not as you would like to be, but the way you actually are, and then see if there are some defilements and problems that you need to overcome to continue your progress on the path. Okay, a couple of more questions perhaps. Dear Arjan, I find I am generally able to have compassion, even metta, towards others who are angry or abusive, but I find it hard to know when I am able to stay protected and when it starts to harm me and I should leave. I tend to have more concern for others than myself, and afterwards get upset with myself for allowing myself to stay in a hostile situation. Where is the balance? The thing really is whether, you know, if you are able to have compassion and metta towards others who are angry and abusive, that's good. That is a very, very positive thing already, if you can do that, because certainly is the right attitude. I think sometimes also, as you say, it is very important to protect yourself. And it is possible to do both. Yeah, it is possible to both walk away and have compassion at the same time. Because you know that being in an abusive situation, very often, in the long run, it's going to drag you down. It's going to make it hard for you to practice your meditation properly. It's going to make it hard for you to kind of spiritually advance. So you try to do both. Yeah, don't be afraid to walk away when it's time to walk away, and have compassion and metta also. So do both of those things. Certainly do protect yourself. Certainly look after yourself. Your main priority should in fact be to look after yourself. And then when you look after yourself, then you're able to protect others. In the end, you have to find out what your balance is. Yeah, how much you can take. But don't be afraid of walking away when things are abusive and difficult, because otherwise you are really letting yourself down. That's what is happening in those kind of situations. Okay, yeah, so see what happens. I think actually I will stop there because there's still a few questions left, but we are kind of making our way through the questions, which is good, because at this time I usually tend to get pretty tired. I can't really answer questions properly anymore, so I might as well stop them. So once again, have a good night, have a good rest, and we'll see you again tomorrow morning. Let's just pay respect to Buddha and the Sangha for the last thing we do now.